Sarco Guerrero has long been a community arts advocate in the Valley. He is known worldwide for his creativity in making masks and sculptures. In tonight's Sounds of Cultura, samples of Sarco Guerrero's artistry. And joining me now is Sarco Guerrero. Sarco, you've been around the Valley for a long time. You're a native Mason.
That's right.
And your art has evolved over time. I mean, you've always done masks. You're well-known. PBS did a documentary on you a number of years ago, and you have many other talents. But let's talk about the evolution of your mask making.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, I think my artistic career really began in the early 70s during the Civil Rights Movement, and more particularly during the Cesar Chavez farm workers movement, of which I became very active as a young man straight out of high school. And that movement inspired me to research our history, our culture, and of course the art of ancient Mexico, as well as the art of the muralists of post-revolutionary Mexico. So I began, you know, participating in that artistic movement during the farm workers movement. And I was motivated to go to Mexico and study the art of Mexico, particularly the art of muralism. I think that's how I really began.
You have a very famous mural at Stanford.
Exactly, uh-huh. I spent a lot of time in Mexico studying muralism. I had the idea of working with Siqueiros, of whom I did meet, but he died shortly after we met. And I ended up working with Francisco Zuniga, the sculptor, in Mexico City. And then later on,
it was also a great influence on R.C. Gorman,
on many artists continually to this day. And very shortly after that, I began an interest in masks, not only because of the beautiful specimens of the masks in the museums of Mexico, but also the masks being used by indigenous people of Mexico, particularly the state of Morelos.
Now your early masks seem to have a lot more of a focus on animals. You'd have the fur, the ears, and so mm-hmm. forth, and teeth. And the newer ones, some of the ones we saw on the screen, are different.
Well, when I began making masks was in Mexico. And the essence of many of the masks of Mexico, of ancient Mexico, was the relationship between man and his environment. So I translated that into a wearable mask I call the Nahual mask that was a at once human and at once animal, that expressed our kinship to the beast. Because we've lost that whole consciousness that we're related and we're part of the animal kingdom. So I wanted to make a statement with my artwork, going back and resurrecting ancient philosophies and ideologies of our ancestors and putting them in the context of contemporary urban Chicano culture.
Now, you've brought a few masks here on the set, and if you'd pick one of them. What I'd like to do is to discuss in ways how you think this reflects an evolution of your work.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is a mask that I do continually, and I have been doing so for many years, the calaca. In Mexico, the calaca represents rebirth, regeneration, and we use the calaca mask for our Dia de los Muertos celebration. In this country, we grow up and we think of the skull as a symbol of death, of poison, of danger. But in Mexico, it has a totally different connotation.
And almost a happy aspect to
the figure. Yeah, it has a happy, welcoming smile, somewhat of a sinister smile. And, of course, it represents our ancestors as well. And the calaca is highly decorated, painted with bright, vibrant colors, so that when we wear the mask for Dia de los Muertos, we get a chance to look death in the face, smile back at death, and accept death as an integral part of life.
And you've got some other ones that I want to take a quick look mm-hmm. at, if you can get them out. But we also want to talk about some upcoming trips you've got to Mexico, or to China, rather, and the connections between that experience and the ones you've had overseas in the past. For example, I know that you studied with mask makers in Japan. Mm-hmm. Let's start there.
Well, I've learned a tremendous amount about life in general, particularly art and culture in Japan, because Japan has maintained the ancient tradition of mask making that goes back 500 years. So I wanted to go to Japan in order to investigate what mask making must have been like in ancient Mexico. And in Japan, I learned about the sanctity of the mask. And the Japanese firmly believe in the power of the mask to transform the person who wears the mask into someone or something else. And also, they have the highest standards in carving the masks. And I wanted to adopt those standards. And I adopted not only the standards, but that Japanese and Asian aesthetic, that I saw parallels between the ancient art of Japan, Indonesia, and China. I saw parallels with the ancient masks of Mexico.
And these included what are referred to as no masks.
The no mask.
Talk to us about those.
Well, the no mask is the ancient ceremonial art of the samurai. And the no masks were derived from the ancient masks of China, of the Buddhist imagery from the temples of ancient China. And so the Japanese saw the power of those deities, of those characters, and those motifs, and recreated them in their own form of ritual theater. And so this is the oldest continually living mask art form in the world. So that's why it was so important for me to go and study.
It has its roots in China, which for a number of years the communist government was suppressing the mask.
Exactly. The mask in so many parts of the world has been relegated to primitive, ancient, pagan societies. I prefer to call those natural societies. And so you have three dominant forms that have suppressed the mask art form, one being communism, the other being Islam, and the other being Christianity. These are three forces that have suppressed and tried to obliterate the mask art form as something of the occult and something pagan, something negative.
And you're going to China?
Yes, sir.
In a way, it's kind of circling back because, as you said, mm-hmm. you encountered in Japan the Chinese mask-making tradition, which had been preserved there. What do you hope to do in China?
Well, I've always been fascinated with the Olmec question. The Olmecs being the first civilization of ancient Mexico, first civilization in the Americas. Everything I do is derived from the aesthetic of the Olmec. And there's many parallels between the Olmec and Chinese imagery. Miguel Covarrubias did a lot of study and published a lot
Very
of articles.
Very famous Mexican
books,
artist.
Mexican artist, anthropologist. And so I've always been the kind of artist that I want to see firsthand. That evidence, those examples. This will be my second trip to China. The first trip I made was 23 years ago, before China opened up.
But you're not going just as a student or a tourist. You're going to perform.
Yes, I've been invited to perform in China at a summer program and to conduct workshops. So I'm very interested in just as I portray my own culture, my own heritage, our society in my mask performance, I have this idea to express and interpret the Chinese themselves.
And you're going to need to express that in about the 30 seconds we have left. And I know you've got a mask here you want to show.
Well, this is one of the type of masks that I've invented. I call it the invisible mask because it's meant to disappear. So this is a type of mask that's unknown in China, unlike the carved mask that they're used to. So I'm going to introduce them to my Chicano tradition of making mask and mask performance.
Well, we wish you well. You're leaving soon?
In July.
Well, thank you for joining us on Horizonte. We'll have you back to talk about how the trip went.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thanks for joining us. Gracias.